The next item on the order paper is a motion on a vision for Northern Ireland outside the European Union. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly, in light of the referendum decision by the United Kingdom to leave the European Union, endorses and adopts the approach contained in A Vision for Northern Ireland Outside the European Union, published by the Ulster Unionist Party.
I call Mr. Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to propose our motion for a vision of Northern Ireland outside the European Union and to recommend that the Northern Ireland Executive endorses and adopts the approach contained within our vision paper that is before the Assembly today. Mr. Speaker, it is nearly 3 months since the referendum that resulted in the people of the United Kingdom voting to leave the European Union. We as a party are conscious that the people of Northern Ireland and Scotland voted to remain within the EU, a position that we, on balance, campaigned for. But we accept that the vote taken will result in the United Kingdom triggering Article 50 in the near future, possibly as early as January 2017. We have asked for this debate because we, as a responsible opposition, wish to encourage our government to action, any action. We have listened closely to civil society, business groups, agriculture, the university sector, the travel industry, and above all, the people of Northern Ireland, who have asked us, time and again, what's being done and what's the plan. We note that across the UK, the other regional governments are already embarked on action. In Scotland, we have seen the formation of a Scottish Standing Council on Europe, a £100 million stimulus package, and they've already taken a proactive approach to getting the best deal for the Scottish people. In Wales, a similar approach is being taken, and detailed discussions have been taking place between the English regions, the City of London, all with Whitehall. Plans have been published, meetings are taking place, and all these regions have defined what the impact of the loss of the EU means to them. What has the Northern Ireland Executive done? Well, they have sent a letter to the Prime Minister on the 10th of August stating what to many, if not all of us, was a statement of the blindingly obvious. Our Executive met the Brexit Minister separately. Our European office in Brussels has set up more teleconferences. Our civil servants, at least some of them, are talking with each other. Oh, and we have the ear of Liam Fox. And that, unfortunately, is about it. Embarrassingly for a devolved government, the Secretary of State has done more. He has established an advisory panel, held talks with our nearest EU neighbour, held a wide series of meetings with key stakeholders, has regular chats with the PM and the naughty trio, all of which is a damning commentary on a dysfunctional non-government. I imagine that David Davis was laughing all the way back to Whitehall and probably still is. A blank sheet of A4, unfortunately, is a good representation of what has been achieved so far. And our people continue to ask, what is the plan? There are no public discussions, not yet. There are no public discussions, debates, grand committees, or even an understanding of the scale of the issues involved. Instead, we have a divided government, pretending to give a facade of unity, but still has no proposals or plans. That is why, in the vacuum that is the government's response to the most significant event to affect our country in over 20 years, we have to take the lead and to publish our vision. We recognise here that in Northern Ireland, our fellow opposition party, half of the government, the Alliance Party and the Green Party are still hoping that the decision to leave can be halted by the courts. While the Ulster Unionist Party recommend remaining, we acknowledge that we must now accept the democratic wishes expressed by the people to leave the European Union. Certainly.
I thank the member for giving way, and I'm sure when he's acknowledging all those who are for advocating what he's advocating, he will also be quick to mention that 85% of unionists voted against staying in the European Union. And no doubt you'll come to that.
Thank you for that. As a responsible opposition, we are now offering a vision and a set of key asks to help prepare Northern Ireland for the forthcoming challenges and potential opportunities ahead. It would also be useful at this stage to state what these challenges are likely to be. Indeed, as the member for South Belfast so regularly and graciously points out, we have not yet fallen off the economic cliff into recession. It is good to note that early action of the Bank of England pumping, not quite yet, £250 billion of quantitative easing. We're answering your question. Pumping £250 billion of quantitative easing into the economy has staved off the immediate crisis. Although this is done by adding a quarter of a trillion to our national debt, which I think is a moot point. However, as PwC have pointed out this month, according to the recent Northern Ireland Economic Outlook, which was published by PwC this week, growth in Northern Ireland for 2016 is forecasted to be 1.2% and expected to slump even further to 0.3% in 2017, worse than the overall UK rates, which are expected to remain between 1.8% in 2016 before dropping to 0.7% in 2017. And as the learned members of the government are fully aware, or should be, broad economic modelling of our economy shows that the Northern Ireland GDP normally lags around 1% behind that of the GB. We as a party do not want to be accused of doing Northern Ireland down. But instead, rather than sticking our collective heads in the sand, we need to face the reality of what is likely to occur. For a start, we're ill prepared as it is without facing a shortfall of between 500 million and perhaps closer to a billion per annum in post-exit funding. We sell Northern Ireland as a great place to do business, which it can be, by pointing out that we have a highly skilled workforce, while conveniently forgetting that most CFOs do read the Financial Times and Bloomberg, and when they do due diligence, something which at least half of our government has a problem with, they discover that our universities are underfunded to the tune of £55 million and are dropping like stones in the global rankings. One of our greatest exports, we seem to export 38% of our brightest youngsters per annum, and we have the second highest cost of energy in Western Europe. We have appalling infrastructure, and now we have no plan for Brexit. But rather than being negative, we need to build a more positive... vision. The border between two great economic groupings can provide considerable economic potential. We have a strong case, if made properly, to become an enterprise zone that could harmonise EU-UK trading positions. And it was good to see, and unfortunately he's not here, the DUP's chief whip support for an enterprise zone around our great international airport last week, and for Mervyn Storey's continued support for the enterprise zone in North Antrim. It is an idea that needs to be explored and already has the support of many business groups here. We would also use any stimulus package for building up our infrastructure, an approach already being taken across the UK, except, of course, here. We should invest heavily in R&D, again using the borrowing potential created by a large scale of quantitative easing. I can already hear the harping of you've always complained about creating more debt and through the executive's new spin doctor, but is the money coming from the magic money tree? Well, guess what? After the referendum, we're in an entirely new dynamic, and the so-called £350 million a week tsunami, a so-called savings from our EU contribution, isn't going to go far. So new ideas about funding will be needed, many of which will involve QE going to infrastructure, though potentially long-term infrastructure bonds, and these are being discussed across the UK. But again, unfortunately, not here. This is not just about economics. We have had a troubled and uncertain history with the Republic of Ireland that has been changed to a positive and growing relationship that has been hard-earned. We can, with sufficient imagination and will, create a dynamic that prevents hard borders, either in Newry or Cairn Ryan, and as proud unionists, it can help us, by achieving these goals, to help maintain the United Kingdom in a manner that avoids our proud nation slipping into xenophobia and isolationism. You also hear from at least 50% of our government that it's too early to begin planning because Article 50 hasn't been triggered, or that they have a special relationship with Downing Street, or that things aren't so bad, and that the falling pound has significantly improved our economy and our manufacturing sector is strong. But if you consider the record over the last 9 years of Sinn Féin DUP majority government, and consider whether they're ready to get the best deal for Northern Ireland, or even if they have a plan. So, Mr. Speaker, we ask the Assembly to endorse and adopt the approach contained within our vision for Northern Ireland outside the European Union. Because, quite frankly, the people of Northern Ireland deserve a plan and deserve the consideration of our government doing something. And our vision is the best and only framework to achieve that. Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Sir, it's always a pleasure to follow the member for South Antrim, for his contributions are always so entertaining. Mr. Speaker, he denigrates the government of Northern Ireland that served for the last 9 years, whilst, of course, conveniently glossing over the fact that the party that he is a member of served in the same government for that period of 9 years. So if he's saying that the government failed to deliver, then he must take responsibility for at least the Ulster Unionist portion of the failure of the government to deliver. A little less of the revision of history would be more welcome from the Ulster Unionist spokesperson. Mr. Speaker, sir, any old opposition can produce uncosted plans. To actually have a costed and sensible plan is the action of a government in waiting, and this is no government in waiting. What we have seen from our friends since they published their document are largely uncosted, untested ideas that they know they won't be able to pay for them. They know that the resource isn't there. And during the contribution that we heard from Mr. Aiken, he made reference to quantitative easing. So we're just going to print more money. Just print more money to pay for their ideas. That's the extent of the ambition that the Ulster Unionist Party's vision, in inverted commas, extends to. Mr. Speaker, since the referendum, I think we have witnessed from those on the Remain side of the campaign in public display the five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and finally acceptance. I welcome the fact that Mr. Aiken has been dragged kicking and screaming to the final stage, acceptance. I wish the same could be said for the other opposition parties, because there seems to be opposition within the opposition to accepting the outcome of the result. And I don't really know what stage some of our more enthusiastic Europhile friends are at. Some are still in denial. Some are very, very angry, largely with the people who beat them in terms of the argument during the campaign. Some are trying to bargain. Well, maybe Article 50 won't be triggered, and maybe this will happen, and maybe that will happen. Some have reached depression, and some will eventually, finally, have to reach acceptance of the decision that was taken by the people of the United Kingdom as a whole in the referendum. And I think the sooner that we get to that point, the better that that will be. Because I do believe that all parties, including those who were on the Remain side in the referendum, have a role to play in ensuring that Northern Ireland secures the best possible outcome. That's what a responsible government is doing, and that's what a responsible opposition should be about. Unfortunately, we have not seen that in terms of the vision that has been offered up to us by the Ulster Unionist Party. And the truth of the matter is, Mr. Aiken tells us that his party recommended a Remain. It's true to say they did. It's true to say that the leadership of his party did. But I would suggest to Mr. Aiken that he should take a straw poll of his colleagues sitting around him at the bottom of the chamber. And he should take a straw poll of Ulster Unionist councillors around Northern Ireland. And he should take a straw poll of the members and voters who voted for the Ulster Unionist Party in recent elections. And I think he will find that not only within unionism, but within Ulster Unionism, the Remain viewpoint was certainly a minority. And so we have this attempt to cover the blush. Yes, I will.
Is it not the case that the former Prime Minister offered the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party tea and sticky buns, and he quickly acquiesced, ignoring what the will of the people in the Ulster Unionist Party, and indeed their voters, actually was?
The member has an extra minute.
I'm grateful. Mr. Speaker, sir. The bark from the dog betrays the fact that it's been hit. The it's guilt, Mr. Speaker, sir. And I am glad, I'm grateful to my friend. Now, Robin, the Chief Whip needs to calm himself, Mr. Speaker. Because the Chief Whip was on the same side as I was during the referendum. He's responsible for party discipline. but he was at one with the Democratic Unionist Party, and I welcome that. I welcome that, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, what we have heard and seen from various parties since the referendum amounts to an undemocratic attempt to overturn the verdict that the people have given. It is in all of our interests, it is in the interests of the people of Northern Ireland, the interests of the people of the United Kingdom, that we accept the outcome and that we now work together in order to deliver the best. I said the best. Don't wave your document at me. I said the best. We now work together, Mr. Speaker, to produce the best possible outcomes for the people of Northern Ireland. And I'm delighted. I'm delighted. And I know we're going to hear a stream of continuing denial and anger about the reality. But the people made their decision. Running off to the courts isn't going to change it. So I urge the opposition, within the opposition, to get with the programme and let's start working to make the best outcome for Northern Ireland. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. John O'Dowd.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to debate today's motion, though we will be voting against the proposal as tabled by the Ulster Unionist Party. It's in a strange way reminds me of the old story or the old saying about the leader standing on the hill and watching his people go by and say, there goes my people, I must follow them. But in this case, the Ulster Unionist Party are not following the people of Ulster. They're following the people of England and Wales. Because 56%, as you're aware, of people here voted to remain within the EU. Over 60% in Scotland voted to remain in the EU. And when the proposer of the motion was outlining what the other devolved administrations were doing, he failed to mention that the Scottish Government is proactively engaged in opposition to being dragged out of the European Union against its will. He failed to mention that important fact. And when those who, from whatever benches in the chamber, will rally cry that Brexit means Brexit, somebody please draw me a diagram of what Brexit means. Because to date, no one has been able to confirm what Brexit means. And indeed, even within the current government in Westminster, they cannot agree on what Brexit means. So, is there a done deal on Brexit? No, there is not. Is there a unified view in what's known as the United Kingdom about Brexit? No, there is not. Is there everything to play for? Of course there is. We're at the start of a journey here, the start of a negotiation about not only the future relationship of what's known as the UK with Europe, we're at the start of a negotiation about the future of what's known as the UK. Because what's quite clear, at the other end of whatever Brexit means, there is going to be significant constitutional change in these islands. And you can be a follower in those circumstances, or you can be a leader in those circumstances. Now, my party makes no apology that we see the way forward for this island as a reunified state. Both socially, culturally and economically, we believe that's the way forward. But we do believe that in the period ahead, that the best place for the North is in the European Union. The best place for the North is in an island of Ireland in the European Union. And the only way to protect the farming industry, communities who rely on peace money, businesses, the four freedoms which the Ulster Unionist Party want to protect in their document is to remain part of the European Union. I'll give way to Lord Morrow first.
And he's at great pains to point out what Scotland did, what Northern Ireland did, what Wales did, what England did in this referendum. But this referendum was not about that. This referendum is about the United Kingdom, of which Northern Ireland is an integral part. And if one Brexit brings one thing, it will surely bring this. It will remove the heavy hand, dead hand of Brussels from the United Kingdom.
Thank you. Well, as I've already stated in this chamber today and previously, there is no unified position in what's known as the United Kingdom in relation to Brussels. And members should be very, very careful for what they wish for. Because if we do want to continue as a trading relationship with the European Union and other parts of the world. These claims that we're going to remove the shackles of Brussels do not stack up or do not add up. And indeed, the Ulster Unionist Party in their document acknowledge that. I'm not going to give away anymore. The Ulster Unionist Party acknowledge that within their document. They realise if we are continue to trade with Europe and the rest of the world that we're going to have to sign up to what's known as the Four Freedoms, that we're going to have to sign up to the European trading arrangements. So what is Brexit about then? What is Brexit about if we remain under the same legislative compasses as we were previously? What is Brexit about if we simply change the title of our relationship with the European Union? Is it about immigration? Is it about xenophobia? Is it about the rise in hate crimes that have been witnessed since the EU referendum? Is that what it's about? Because if that's what it's about, then let's be honest with each other, and people should stand up in this chamber and say that's what it is about. No, because our industries, our agri-food industry, our agricultural industries need European labour. There are significant employers in this society who will not remain here if they do not have access to European labour. So when members in the chamber who support exiting the European Union, and who support exiting the European Union on the belief that they're going to control immigration, and when they pull down those barriers, and if they force thousands upon thousands of European citizens to leave these islands, remember the impact you're having on the agri-food industry, the agri-industry and other industries in this society. And also remember what you're going to do to some of your friends in the property markets, because they rent properties, they buy properties and they invest in this society. So I would ask for caution in relation to people's hopes and expectations around the Brexit, but I will put on the record, this is not a done deal, and my party will continue to campaign for the North to remain in the European Union, and we will be calling on others to support that, and we will be working with whatever governments are on this island or other islands to ensure that we do remain within the European Union.
Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I appreciate the Ulster Unionists bringing this work forward. They deserve some credit for at least articulating some of the issues that are facing Northern Ireland. We will agree to disagree on whether this is Plan B or Plan A. We're definitely not in the latter group. But we do share some of their concerns about the conditions and the investments that this place needs to enjoy. I think the thing that frustrates me and many others about Brexit is the opportunity cost and the lost time. Many of us came to this debate from the Refugees Welcome demonstration at the front organised by Niagara and Amnesty. And all. That was a massive political problem that the European Union really had to get to grips with. And instead of all those diplomats and policymakers and resources and drafters spending time addressing that huge political problem that affects and saves the lives of millions of people, we are instead wasting our time trying to unsolve an unsolvable conundrum that didn't have to be thrown in our future. The executive parties might dispute this, but it's not in the SDLP's nature to be obstructionist, but we believe that it is firmly our duty, not just respecting the will of the vast majority of the people here who voted to remain in the European Union and for the stability and the opportunity and the diversity that that represents, but we believe that as legislators and as people elected to guard the public interest, it is our duty to do all we can to prevent this unnecessary change from happening. And we're not alone. They're not alone. There are people, senior people in every party, that understand that very possibly Theresa May is seeking excuses not to trigger Article 50. And unnecessary as we think that is, we will continue to put forward and take any opportunity that we have to prevent that from happening. I will address the specific issues in the paper, which I think are a useful overview. And I think many don't think we're being too cynical to think that the executive's continued line of "we're not revealing our negotiating hand" is a cover from "we did no contingency planning, we were banking on this not happening, and even if we had any ideas, we can't agree on them." I noticed that the member before didn't bother wasting any of his 5 minutes actually setting out how we're going to deal with this problem, but instead threw punches all around this chamber. 30 seconds, even to update us, 30 seconds to update us on where our $350 million is for the NHS wouldn't have been too long in the 6 minutes that we had. So just looking at some of the issues raised, a trebling of infrastructure, this, you know, regardless of our future, it is vital. People look at the Republic and the advances that it's secured through corporation tax and fail to learn the lesson. Investors aren't hanging around just waiting for the right tax deal. They want the skills, they want the infrastructure. I've said before, I'm from Galway and I drive up and down many times in the year, and I drive through small towns like Athenry with massive tech jobs that our young people deserve. They deserve those opportunities here, and they didn't come just through the low tax rate. They came through investment in skills and infrastructure. Never mind the fact that London has effectively stolen our lunch by proposing to reduce their own corporation tax rate, but this executive hasn't set out how that policy will exist if we are outside of the European Union. The enterprise zone links into some of the issues above. We believe that in the main the European Union has done well to balance the interests of businesses and employees, and we would like that framework in terms of employment law and protections to remain, and some of that can be discussed. Education and skills, as above, you know, those 21st century high quality jobs, we deserve them here. Many of the businesses who wanted to invest here wanted us as a gateway to Europe, and if that's not there, we don't know how attractive that proposal is. Financial guarantees, we wish to see these too, and we repeatedly restated the lack of guarantees, but the fact is that even if London shared the detailed interest in our well-being, and I don't believe that they do, there is no guarantee that the UK's economy will remain strong enough to do this. I won't have time to cover all of them, but you know, issues like research and development and innovation, the European Horizon 2020 Fund, if we are outside Europe, people need to explain how and if we'll have access to that. Common travel and the avoidance of a hard border, we would need longer than the hour and a half. But those who are saying neither of the governments want this to change have yet to set out how they're going to keep what we have in place and how they square that circle that the whole argument was about protecting our borders and keeping Johnny Foreigner out. But how do you do that when our near neighbour is perfectly entitled to have European consistent immigration policies? Similarly, the legal and regulatory framework, we couldn't possibly begin to unpick that. And we haven't heard from those who want to get our laws back from the faceless bureaucrats. They haven't set out their alternative. So we welcome the Ulster Unionists having the discussion. It's more than the executive have done, but we agree that it's a bit too early to go to Plan B.
I call Stephen Farrey.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I think this debate is probably of most use if we see it as a take-note debate in terms of the response to date, or the lack of response to date, from the executive to Brexit, rather than an effort to endorse the view of one political party. There may well be some useful points in the document which do indeed reflect things that are said by my party and indeed others, and also parts of the business community and civil society. But I do take issue with the notion of reconciling the words "a vision for Northern Ireland" and the word "outside the European Union." To my mind, Northern Ireland being outside the European Union is a negative. The issue is how deep and far-reaching the implications and consequences are going to be, and how we can actually move to address all of those. The document itself is actually framed at one part of a spectrum of different responses that we can envisage. First of all, there are the ongoing legal challenges, which are about ensuring a proper constitutional process rather than necessarily trying to stop Brexit itself, and that those will work their way through the courts in due course, no doubt. The second aspect in terms of responses is how Northern Ireland can influence the UK negotiating position and seek to mitigate the effects of Brexit. And that's where this document lies in terms of that particular spectrum. And to date, the response from the executive has been poor. We have seen the much more coherent response from Scotland, the much more united response from Scotland. By contrast, we've had a letter from our First Minister and Deputy First Minister, which very much reflects the lowest common denominator of agreement. And even there, there were a number of important issues that were neglected within that letter. And I appreciate it is somewhat of an embarrassment in terms of the DUP having campaigned to leave, to now actually accept many of the points that were made by the Remain side during the referendum. But even with that, they're not fully grasping the full spectrum of the implications for Northern Ireland. The final point on that spectrum is actually whether we can work out some type of special arrangement or special status for Northern Ireland, whether that is in terms of preferential access to the European Union or indeed as a region within the European Union. We could see a situation where, in line with the principle of consent, Northern Ireland does remain part of the UK, where we have a strong relationship with our neighbours in the Republic of Ireland, but also we have a strong relationship with Brussels. And that may well be something that's much more consistent with the fact that we are a very particular place in a particular political situation, the fact that we are still very much a contested state, the fact that the people of Northern Ireland did vote to remain, and indeed that we have the right to determine our own future, reflected in terms of the Good Friday Agreement itself. It is worth reflecting that even if we don't manage to have a coherent position from our executive in due course that actually can seek to negotiate some type of special status, a special status, or rather an anomaly, will emerge by default. And it's important that we bear that in mind. There cannot be a clean Brexit for the UK as a whole, and certainly not for the situation in Northern Ireland. First of all, we share a land border on the island of Ireland. That brings some particular complexities. And secondly, people who are born in Northern Ireland have the right to be Irish citizens and, by default, European Union citizens. That's something different from the context elsewhere in the UK. So that brings its own particular situation as well. In terms of the effects of Brexit, there's probably four that I would wish to highlight in particular. First of all, we have the financial impact in terms of the loss of revenue. And I appreciate the UK as a whole may well have been a net contributor, but Northern Ireland itself was a net beneficiary. And even if we take the UK perspective, the UK actually had much more to gain in terms of the ability to trade and its location for inward investment. Today we've seen some very difficult economic speculation. And whenever we see the UK as a whole, the figures moving in the wrong direction, Northern Ireland structurally is actually quite a number of points of a percent behind in many respects, so there's a danger there. Thirdly, we have the complications around the border. And unless we have the softest of soft Brexits, we will see a situation where there's a different immigration regime and a different trading regime between the Republic of Ireland as part of the European Union and the UK. That has to be policed in some manner. So we could see that policing done on a line across the island or down the Irish Sea. If it's done down the Irish Sea, then we are looking at one massive anomaly to handle. And that's before we can come to the implications for the Good Friday Agreement and the balance of relationships that were carefully set out in that document, which very much depend upon the European Union facilitating freedom of movement, the immigration policy and trading policy. The danger of that now becomes unpicked with massive consequences for our political future. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Call Gordon Lyons.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to take part in this debate today. I suppose we'll start off on the positive. That's one good thing that comes from the motion that is before the House. It's interesting, though, isn't it, to reflect on the debate that took place here in the days after the 23rd of June. I remember the debate that took place in this House. I remember the prophets of doom. I remember those who were saying that all sorts of terrible things were going to happen in terms of jobs and in terms of the economy. And indeed, our good friend, Mr. Aiken, Mr. Recession himself, deep recession, actually, are the words that he used. That, of course, hasn't come to pass. Oh, but of course, people say, oh, that's not going to happen now. We mean that's going to happen later on. That's going to happen once Brexit comes. But the goalposts have been moved a little bit already in regards to this. So I think the members sitting on the benches at the end of the chamber will understand why my party will not be supporting the motion that is here today. Yes, the members may not like to hear that, but I doubt that they are surprised. Because what we have in front of us here, Mr. Speaker, it's not a vision at all. It's platitudes, very little on substance. Yes, yes, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I have not produced a plan, but I am not the opposition. But I am not the opposition, and I am not the executive either. Now, the executive, of course, on the other hand, and the Ulster Unionist Party love to say that the executive have done nothing in terms of preparing for Brexit. Of course, they don't know what is going on.
because they didn't take up their ministerial positions. They didn't take up their ministerial positions. They decided not to be part of a government that is instructing their officials to prepare, that is meeting with other government ministers, that is preparing for the challenges. And indeed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, the opportunities that can come from Brexit, because that is what this document is very light on. Nothing in here about the opportunities. Yes, it talks about some of the challenges that we're going to face. Yes, it asks for some answers, but there is nothing in here about making the most of the opportunities that can come from Brexit. And that's why we can't be supporting it. There's no vision in here whatsoever. So we will not give way to Mr. Prince.
Thank you. Is it not important to set out a vision in advance of an election and then put that to the people, as this party did? Yes. And the Ulster Unionist Party obviously put a vision of some kind to the public, but that was rejected. And that is the position that we're in today. The DUP have a vision, and it has been accepted by the public, and we'll work that through.
Well, of course, Mr. Putz is absolutely correct. The Ulster Unionist Party did put a vision for the country ahead of the for the people in front of the Assembly election, and that was rejected. Of course, they didn't put a vision for the EU before the EU referendum, because they didn't have one, because they were so badly divided on it, because they were all pointing in different directions. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we are very clear in regards to our position. We believe that the United Kingdom as a whole is better off outside the European Union. We have seen already how the scaremongering from other parties in this House, and indeed other parties across the UK, has been found to be completely false. So we are now trying to make sure that we get the very best deal for the people of Northern Ireland. We will work with the European Union, we will work with Her Majesty's Government, and we will even work with other parties in this chamber to ensure that we get the best deal that we can. I'll give way once more to Mr. Stolford.
Unfortunately, she wouldn't give way to me, but when the member for South Belfast refers to people who voted to leave the European Union as being about getting a Johnny Foreigner, do you agree with me that that's precisely the type of sneering, arrogant comment, the cost remain, the referendum? Sneering at ordinary voters and accusing them of being closet racists because they didn't vote the way that you wanted them to vote.
Well, Mr. Deputy Speaker, Mr. Stolford makes a very good point, because a lot of people like to say that this all came, that the result of the EU referendum came or was entirely because of immigration. That wasn't the case at all. In fact, that shows how out of touch some people are. I will finish my point first. That shows how out of touch some people are, because the people that I spoke to on the doorsteps, yes, they had concerns about immigration and concerns about our borders, but they also had concerns about where our money was being spent in Europe. They also had concerns about our ability to be outward looking and trade freely with the rest of the world. So for members to say that this was some kind of xenophobic, inward looking people that enabled this result to happen shows just how out of touch and how wrong they are. And on that point, I will give way.
The member will note, and the answer will show, that I referred to the campaigners and to the campaigns which focused on immigration issues, as well as the mystery $350 million. And I note that still none of you has updated us on that. But will the member agree? Will the member agree that at no point did the Leave campaign defend those racists? Did no point did anybody stand up during the campaign and protest against xenophobic signs showing lines of people queuing up at the border of an entirely different country? And will the member agree that the position that you took in your August letter was a U-turn when you finally acknowledged the need for migrant labour here and outlined why that need was not outlined during your campaign?
Éireann Saoire, Declan McAleer. Call Declan McAleer.
Yeah, and I'm thankful for the opportunity to speak on today's motion before the House here today. Our membership of the EU has a wide and significant impact on our lives, and the areas I want to just speak on briefly here today is on infrastructure and on rural development and agriculture. Certainly within here in the north and throughout Ireland, and indeed the EU, Transport is crucial. It's absolutely crucial for the free movement of goods, services and people. And that's reflected in our PFG framework, and also in one of the most recent published articles or white papers in the EU roadmap to a single European transport area, which sets out a long-term strategy for the EU transport system to make it more efficient. Central to that there, and we spoke about here in the House before, is the TEN-T, the Trans-European Network. The TEN-T is a multi-billion pound pot which is used for the funding of intermodal networks throughout the EU. And the objective is to decrease these bottlenecks between the EU member states to enable the free flow of goods and services and indeed people. And one of the objectives of this is to have the network created by 2030. So obviously from our perspective here, it begs the question, if the exit happens, what will our access be to that pot? And what will happen to this part of Europe as the rest of Europe develops their comprehensive TEN-T network of ports, rail, roads throughout the EU? The dangerous, we're on the periphery of it, we could be more isolated and left behind. Indeed, the EU has been quite significant. Funds have come into the EU over the course of the last 10 years for infrastructure in the region of 100 million. And that includes 58 million in TEN-T projects for the likes of the A8 and the development of the transport hub in Belfast. And we know also that there are projects such as the York Street Interchange, which is eligible for the likes of TEN-T funding. And there are others like the A2. Indeed, the A5 and the A6 are part of the TEN-T comprehensive network, not eligible for the entire main pot, but eligible for parts of it because it's part of the comprehensive network. Indeed, last week at the Infrastructure Committee, we heard from Dr. Grieve about the Greenway strategy and how Interreg 5 will be eligible to develop a Greenway network throughout the north. And we've seen in County Monaghan recently where they secured $4 million for their Greenway to bring it right up to the border at Middletown and County Armagh. But in leaving the EU, obviously, that raises questions about our accessibility to pots of money such as they got there for infrastructure projects. Turning to rural development, I think it's very important to point out that 87% of farmers' income in the north is single farm payment. Single farm payment is just under £250 million a year, and there's a pot that was negotiated during the recent cap reform in the region of £2 billion right up to 2020. Certainly begs the question, if the exit happens, where does that come from? Where does 80% of the farmers, 87% of the farmers' income come from in the context of exiting from the EU? On top of that there, look at the £623 million Rural Development Programme, signed off last August 2015. Opened up exciting opportunities for rural areas, the £250 million Farm Business Improvement Scheme, £65 million for ANC, £10 million for rural tourism, and £70 million for LEADER, which is funding for rural projects, small business in local areas, community projects, crashes, a whole range of them. And that is in the process of being delivered. And I note correspondence that I got from the Minister recently where no guarantees can be given beyond 2018 for that, even though the budget has been agreed up to 2020, the term of the cap. And this Rural Development Programme, being a former member of the Dáil Committee, I know that this was hard fought for. It was hard fought for at European level, and the data had to be agreed and negotiated here as well in terms of top it up, because we must remember that their budget, the Tories actually negotiated a cut during the cap negotiations. They negotiated a 22% cut during the cap negotiations for that funding. So we then had a bridge that shortfall here. And I think that fact alone, that the Tories negotiated a cut during the cap negotiations in 2014, proves that they don't really give a damn about here. And so I think it's fanciful thinking that we should create these wish lists, thinking that they will somehow bridge the gap. So in conclusion, the North is one of the highest areas of unemployment disadvantage in these islands. The danger of exiting is that we will end up being more peripheralised than ever, a huge impact on our communities. We've heard from speakers previously, there is no such thing as an easy Brexit, and the best chance that we have for the future prosperity of the North, and indeed this island, is for everyone to weigh in behind the Remain campaign. Graham Margaret.
I call Philip Smith.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, most affected, least prepared. That is the best summary of our current position as Northern Ireland faces a unique challenge as a result of Brexit. We are the only region with an EU land border that needs to remain fully open. Agri-food is our largest industry, which will be massively impacted by any reduction in subsidy, but faces even greater danger from potential tariffs if we no longer have single market access under existing terms. Our local economy shows no sign of recovery 9 years, 9 years after recession, and our net income from the EU is over £500 million per year, which will be slashed if future allocations are based purely on the Barnett formula. The enormity of the task ahead should concern everyone in this chamber. We need to fully understand the implications of Brexit for Northern Ireland and be in a position to articulate our requirements to Westminster and beyond. If we think that London will prioritise our needs of agri-food and manufacturing over the City of London, we will be in for a rude awakening. Furthermore, the UK Government is frankly making this up as they go along. Brexit means Brexit, means whatever you want it to mean. The capacity does not exist in London to come up with all the answers on this. They are looking for ideas and proposals, and that is why we must be clear on our requirements and have a thought-out Brexit plan for Northern Ireland. That is why it is so unbelievable that we have seen no action, no proposals, no plan from, as we have seen today, a totally split executive on this issue. That is also why the Ulster Unionist Party is engaged with civic society and, in the absence of anything from the executive, have developed this policy document in front of us today. Gavin Robinson, when critiquing this document in the media, asked, "Was this all we had produced in 2 months?" The irony that his party is meant to be in government and that their science is deafening appeared to be lost on him. Scotland, and I'm no fan of the SNP, but to be fair to them, they have appointed a Brexit minister to argue Scotland's case. They've set up a statutory committee to monitor progress and have introduced an expert advisory body to guide the Scottish Government through this process. Our First Ministers have sent a letter. The comparison does not flatter us. Our government needs to up its game before we are further disadvantaged. I voted for and campaigned for Remain, but I accept the result and the democratic will of the UK electorate. I see no value in trying to fight rearguard actions. We need to identify opportunities from the Brexit process, and that is why our document provides a vision for the future, to make Northern Ireland the UK's gateway to the EU. We also need to see evidence that the executive is getting Northern Ireland Brexit ready. We propose the setting up of a Brexit war room with the skills and capacity to identify the best policy options and priorities for Northern Ireland so that we are well prepared and have an effective voice in the upcoming negotiations. Our 10 key asks in the paper recognise the scale of Brexit's impact on Northern Ireland and therefore show that we need ambition if we are to put in place the transformational policies required to deliver our positive vision. The key words, ambition, transformation and vision, that is what Northern Ireland both needs and deserves. We want a massive increase in infrastructure investment to create an economic stimulus to break out of our bottom of the league growth and provide the connectivity required for success in the 21st century. To transform our economy, we must turn all of Northern Ireland into an enterprise zone and create an emphasis on skill development to build the most skilled workforce in Western Europe in our chosen industries. In recognition of our unique status, the executive must secure guarantees that no group in Northern Ireland will be worse off financially for 5 years post-Brexit. To deliver our vision for Northern Ireland post-Brexit, we must have continued access to the European single market and a continuation of the common travel area with the Republic, with no hard border to GB ports and airports disadvantaging Northern Ireland. These are our requirements to ensure that Northern Ireland is Brexit ready. The Ulster Unionist Party has risen to the challenge to fill the gap in leadership and direction from the executive. No doubt some today will criticise, but their voices will have little credibility in the absence of their own proposals. Northern Ireland needs a plan. We have provided one. Unless this chamber wishes to continue as the region most affected, least prepared, I urge you to support. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Conor Murphy. I call Conor Murphy.
And I welcome the opportunity to speak on this, although I don't particularly think that the party opposite are very sincere in bringing this. They can't possibly imagine that anyone would sign up to that vision that they have put to us today. I don't think they fully expect that. I think, to be quite honest, looking at the demeanour over there, I think they're here for the crack. Anyway, they've asked us to sign up to a vision, which fails at the first hurdle, because it asks us to sign up to a vision which is the position of the North outside the EU, which is actually in defiance of the mandate that the people of the North give us during the referendum, which was to defend the position of the North inside the EU. And that's clearly what we intend to do. When my colleague, Mr. O'Dowd, put it to them that the stock answer, Brexit means Brexit, has become a cliche, and the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party waved his document as if it was the modern version of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and all the answers to what Brexit actually means are contained within that, which again I find somewhat laughable. Having read through the document itself, there is no solution within it. It's predicated on the wrong basis. It's predicated on the generosity of the British government, who remain committed to huge cuts in spending, public expenditure, and who have, over the last number of years, since they came to power, supported by the Ulster Unionist Party at that time when the Conservatives came back into power, have decimated the budgets available to the executive, have actually reduced our public spend, have put severe pressures on spending on things like health, education and infrastructure, and yet somehow the document that the Ulster Unionist Party have produced, probably over a cup of coffee on a Friday afternoon, have somehow, in a magic wand, waved away their role in putting such a government into position in the first instance, but also an assumption that this government will actually do a complete U-turn in terms of their desired and continued desired objective of reducing the budget deficit through huge cuts in public spending. It's also predicated on an uncosted, other people have pointed this out, spending spree on behalf of the executive. A threefold increase in spending and infrastructure, which would be wonderful. Absolutely. Well, I'm sure everybody around the House would welcome a threefold expenditure on infrastructure going forward, absolutely, and a huge amount of expenditure in other areas. Yet the same UUP, as long back ago as July, issued a statement criticising the executive for what they considered unsustainable borrowing and spending plans, and yet they wish to raise by the level of three the amount of expenditure on infrastructure. They called and particularly criticised the finance minister and asked him to recognise that every pound borrowed today will mean that even more have to be repaid by future generations. And yet they have brought a proposition to the House today to ask everyone to sign up to a vision which includes a huge amount of public expenditure, not costed, not budgeted for, and only in July, a matter of public criticism from the party themselves. They have also rehashed the enterprise zone proposition. And again, that comes from the 2010 document produced by, people may remember, UKONF. It sounds now more like an accusation than a political consideration that was put at that time. But I think, certainly, I suppose if there were any plaudits to be given for the document that the Ulster Unionist Party have produced, there would be a recycling award. I think certainly it should merit some consideration for that. And so clearly it's predicated on the generosity of a British government which no longer exists and hasn't existed since they assisted in putting it into power. It's predicated on the basis of ignoring the mandate that was given to us by the people of the North to remain within the EU. And it's also predicated on a completely uncosted spending set of spending propositions, which they know from their relationship with their former electoral partners in the Conservative Party that the executive have absolutely no possibility of getting access to. And I listened to the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party being interviewed, and he says, well, if there is all this more money to come, surely we can spend it on this. And if that's the basis of this proposition, then I think we're all in trouble. I don't think it would be any surprise to the Ulster Unionist Party, and I don't think they expected anything less than that. Although, in fairness, I think a debate on the implications of Brexit is welcome, albeit, I think, on the basis of a document which no one, and I'm sure probably, if truth be told, half of the members sitting on those benches over there either
could sign up to.
Would the member
draw his marks to a close, please? Thank you. Éireann Saoire, Sinéad Bradley. I call Sinéad Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Chair. Firstly, I would like to echo the comments made by my colleague, Claire Hannah, that it is nice that we have an opportunity to actually look at a document to speak to in this House. And when I compare the document to that of the government, of course there's no comparison to be drawn because there is none. We have nothing more than a letter. And it does amuse me slightly to watch debate in this House while a debate on Brexit becomes nothing more than a heckling and shouting match. And then very good manners are being attributed when others in government are speaking. And it really is disgraceful that people within this House have come here today without even the open mind of discussing How is Northern Ireland going to look? What are the consequences? Why has the debate today not raised up issues around single farm payment? Businesses are looking for leadership. Businesses are making decisions based on the uncertainties that we face. And the debate in this House today offered nothing from the government parties to say to them that we are even sitting down to consider what's happening. In fact, nowhere in this House can we look for a wider, alleged wider position between the two governments, one for Remain and one for Exit. And I say alleged position because I see neither party doing a whole lot about either position that they hold. And I look at them and I think the one agreed position that appears to have been adopted by this government is that if we do nothing, the opposition cannot scrutinise that. If we do nothing, nobody can say that we're doing it the wrong way. Nobody can say that our priorities are different to what they should be. And quite frankly, that's where we're at. That's where this debate is at. There has been nothing shared in this chamber by the government parties today that is worthy of me carrying out of this chamber to those people who have genuine concerns, those people who are making decisions in boardrooms, in small businesses, on whether their business is going to survive, those people who are dependent on the agricultural policies to keep their farm businesses open, those people who are asking questions about, will my son or daughter be able to carry on in this farm enterprise? There are no answers. There is no thinking. There is no pathway that has been pointed out here today that I can offer any assurance to any of those people. And I think the level of debate that has been offered here is nothing short of disgraceful. I have stood and I've listened to different debates where people are very comfortable at breaking down geographically, boastfully telling us that their constituency voted to leave. And yet the mantra of this is a UK decision quickly follows. I also listened to Lord Morrow telling me very eloquently about how the majority are unionists who have voted to remain. Therefore, he can cite that and be dismissive of the fact that the majority of people in Northern Ireland voted. Yes, I will give a.
I think the member is slightly confused. I said no such thing. What I did say when I spoke to address an issue that the Ulster Unionists were putting forward was that the majority of unionists who were voting, namely 85% of those unionists, voted to leave the EU. And I have a high regard for the member, but she is now treading very, very close onto what we have come to expect from those who voted to remain. They want to talk down to everybody. The little people have spoken and they've said, we want the dead hand of Brussels removed. And you and I and the Ulster Unionists and Sinn Féin should respect that.
The member has an extra minute added to her.
Thank you. And may I remind the member that we are members of the Northern Ireland Assembly. I am elected to represent the people of Northern Ireland, a truth that may sit uncomfortably with the member when he makes his reference. I do not dismiss the majority voice of Northern Ireland. If you feel comfortable and take some security in breaking it down into green and orange, then do that. But do not do it in the hope that people, I will in a moment, in the hope that people will not notice that this government is actually doing nothing. Yes, I will.
Giving way, would she agree with me that there are actually ordinary people on both sides of the argument, both in the UK as a whole and also in Northern Ireland? And also, whenever Lord Morrow refers to 85% of unionists having voted to leave, he has no basis for making that claim. That is an entirely fabricated statistic, just like all the other ones from the Leave campaign.
Yes, I do agree with that, and we will put that to the catalogue of statistics that we can never really put our finger on. But I basically do think, and in winding up, and I won't keep, because I think the level of debate, what has come out, if you stand on your feet to make any argument for or against Brexit, and you do not find yourself uttering the word single farm payment, you do not find yourself uttering the words that are relative and relevant to our business community, then I ask you, please be seated and go away and find a think tank. And perhaps the appointment of external bodies or external people, which we're not allowed to discuss, apparently, because democracy with a small d on certain days. That is not
the member's time's up.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The Green Party campaigned for the UK to remain part of the EU. And it's unsurprising that that continues to be our position, that having seen a vote in Northern Ireland, a majority vote to remain, that we continue to uphold that position and to seek to represent those who wish to remain. Northern Ireland did not vote to leave. Northern Ireland does not want to leave, and Northern Ireland would be significantly disadvantaged if we did eventually exit the European Union. And I've listened to this debate and the statistic that came out, 85% of unionists, and I would query that one, I would query continually breaking down this society into unionism versus nationalist. Green is orange, it's often put, although there are other shades of green. But I look at my own constituency. For those who like to view the world in those terms, a unionist constituency, 4 unionist MLAs, no nationalist MLAs, yet a majority voted to remain. So the statistic doesn't stack up to any proper scrutiny. But the motion asks us to envisage a Northern Ireland outside the EU, and let's address it in that regard. If we are going to leave, how best can we mitigate against the damage, is how I see it, that would do to Northern Ireland. And I think it's important that we do work together. And the proposal of the motion, I know, has been constructive in cross-party discussions, how we can act together, how we can get an agreed platform on how best we should act in the interests of the people of Northern Ireland. And that's why, to some extent, it's maybe a question of phrasing, that the motion's a bit disappointing, and it calls us then to endorse an Ulster Unionist position. Not a cross-party agreed position, but an Ulster Unionist position. If it was a proposal for discussion, yes, absolutely. And many have said it's welcome in that regard. But I think seeking the endorsement at this stage is taking us a bit far. I'll address some of the aspects of it that I would have difficulty with. I think in terms of securing maximum funding for Northern Ireland, existing EU funding, I think we're going to get cross-party consensus on that type of issue. But then there's some genuine policy decisions we would have to make in post-Brexit if it were to happen. How do we want to address the issue of environmental protection? And I'm heartened by the call in this document for continued protection of our natural environment and our biodiversity. And I think, excellent, that's something we can agree to and we can sign up to. But the same document calls for Northern Ireland to be an enterprise zone with a deregulation of planning. Well, in general, those planning functions are there to protect our environment. So do we want to protect or do we want to deregulate? Because the two rarely go hand in hand. And in fact, explicitly, the document calls for protection of biodiversity, but then also calls for the scrapping of fishing quotas, which are designed precisely to protect our biodiversity. And again, we've had in Northern Ireland the debate about corporation tax, and I've long stood as an opponent, and the Green Party has long stood as an opponent to the proposed reduction in corporation tax, and we see further proposals to reduce taxation in this document. But at the same time, we call for more for Northern Ireland. So we go to the government and say, we want to give back less, but we want to take more. And whilst it's not a bad place to start, it's not a bad ask. I don't think anyone here would disagree with us paying less in and getting more back. But I suspect we have to anticipate the possibility that the British government will not be predisposed to that argument. I think we do and can work together to make a coherent argument why Northern Ireland should be made a special case. We have seen that done in relation to corporation tax. We've seen it done in relation to air passenger duty. And I think in terms of this EU referendum, we can do that. But we must work together and agree our asks first.
Call Gerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and there will be some things in this document that I would agree with, such as securing the financial guarantees of those who are in receipt of EU funding, securing the common travel area, making sure there's no hard border, and making sure that there's increased investment into infrastructure. The document also briefly refers to the freedom of movement of labour, something that my party is resolutely in support of, particularly given the huge benefits economically and culturally that migrants bring to our society. I will not. Indeed, our NHS would struggle to survive if it wasn't for the vital work carried out by migrants in our health service. And if we can have the movement of capital around the world with a click of a button, then the movement of human beings across the world should be a guaranteed right. Though I suspect, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that we would go further than the proposers of this motion. Indeed, we are for the freedom of movement of all people, be they EU citizens or non-EU citizens. And today's demonstration, a Stormont, about the refugee crisis should serve and act really as a horrible reminder of the reactionary role that the EU has played in creating a fortress Europe which keeps refugees caged behind fences, which says nothing, of course, of the comments made by a member of this House, a representative of the Ulster Unionist Party, that is proposing this motion, no less, who thought it funny to equate refugees with dogs. Shame on the member for such disgraceful remarks. That said, Mr. Speaker, there is some common ground between what I might call the establishment opposition in this chamber and the anti-establishment socialist opposition that I'm a member of on this side of the chamber. However, I think the difficulty and the problem with this, I will not, with this establishment style of opposition, is that it doesn't really offer a radically different alternative to the one presented by the executive. For example, this document calls for the creation of an enterprise zone, which is in reality just a slightly more right-wing version of the economic strategy outlined by the executive itself. And take, for example, the issue of corporation tax. The anti-establishment opposition in this side of the chamber has long warned that talk of reducing corporation tax would be a race to the bottom, costing working-class people and public services hundreds of millions of pounds, with only the wealthiest gaining from it. And we have the evidence in front of us with it, with Mr. Nesbitt in his document, his party document, suggesting to go further and calling for not a 12.5 rate of corporation tax, but to lower it even further to 10%. And then who knows, maybe 8, 6 or 5% in the future. And the executive, Mr. Deputy Speaker, might well have initiated this race to the bottom, but now the establishment opposition and the Ulster Unionist Party in particular seems determined to take pole position in this race to the bottom. And it's a failure, in my opinion.
Point of order. Will the member be seated, please?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I know the member is newly elected, but a moment ago he made a very serious accusation, an attack on a party colleague who asked for an intervention to defend and explain herself. The member did not allow it. I think that's very poor form.
Just on that matter, if the member wishes to make and register a complaint around that to the Speaker's office, she is entitled to do so in her own right. Please continue.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's a failure, in my opinion, that this motion merely calls for an accelerated and more extreme
version of the executive's own economic programme. There's no evidence, Mr Deputy Speaker, that a reduction in corporation tax will be beneficial to the mass of people who live here, and it will likely wipe hundreds of millions of pounds from the public sector and almost certainly lead to job losses rather than job creation. I think the most important point to be made here, Mr Deputy Speaker, is that we live in a post-Brexit world, but the contours of what that may look like have not been determined for the future. There are some positives in this motion, but all in all, it falls short of the kind of radical alternative that we need. And this kind of alternative that the anti-establishment opposition stands for is one where we unite ordinary people across the north and south, and rather than roll the red carpet out for corporations like Apple, like Google, like Starbucks, to make them pay. Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker.
I call Edwin Putt. Point of order, yes.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I would ask that the member withdraw his comments and apologise to me before I take up the opportunity of reporting it formally.
That may well not be a point of order, but I suggest that in regard to this matter, if the member subsequently, during the course of the debate, wishes to intervene, and if he interprets your remarks to be correct, he may do so. However, if you have a particular complaint, as I outlined earlier, you may do so directly to the Speaker's office.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. We're used to shrill voices, excitement, animation when it comes to discussions around Brexit. And today it's been slightly less shrill, although some members have been working themselves up quite well. But we were told before all of this, you know, in an attempt to browbeat the public in the United Kingdom, in an attempt to scare them, that house prices would collapse. They haven't. We were told that interest rates would go up. They have went down. We were told food prices would go up. They haven't. We were told that farm gate prices would go down. They have went up. We were told that share prices would go down. They have went up. And we were told that emergency budget would be initiated, and it hasn't. Yes, sir, of course, I'll give up.
I thank the member for giving way. Would he concede that we haven't actually left the European Union yet, which is something that people seem to have missed in all of this debate?
The problem is that the people were telling us it was going to happen immediately. We weren't going to be waiting to leave the European Union. So we've now got the delayed apocalypse that was predicted by the Alliance Party, the SDLP and others in this House. And thankfully, it hasn't been the case. I heard someone speaking today about farmers as if he was representative of farmers. The farmers voted heavily to get out of Europe. Heavily. And nationalist farmers were voting quite heavily to get out of Europe. And that was the feedback that I was getting. And they were told they were mad. You're going to lose out so much. Well, the single farm payment has been guaranteed by the United Kingdom government for this period of time. And anybody who has an ounce of sense will know that the single farm payment beyond this period of time was going to come down because the accession countries were promised in the previous negotiation that they would get more. And the only way that they would get more is that if it's taken off the countries who are getting it now, or alternatively, Europe takes more money off the taxpayer to give to farmers in Eastern Europe. So greater subsidies was going east, and farmers had the common sense to see that. What farmers did vote to get away from, however, was over 2,700 different regulations applied to them as they carry out their daily activities. Farmers were sick to the teeth of being regulated by Europe. Many other businesses are sick to the teeth of being regulated by Europe. The red tape that is being applied to them is unnecessary. It is holding business back, and businesses therefore will be better off outside of Europe because they will have the opportunity
of actually getting on with the job in hand. And Mr. O'Dowd didn't give way to me when it was requested, so I'll not reciprocate kindly to him on this occasion. In terms of this, people wanted rid of the shackles of Europe. People wanted democracy restored. The public wanted democracy. And the first line of democratic government, in my opinion, is local government, then it's regional government, and then national government. Europe is the most undemocratic element of our governance. And yet, for example, on environmental issues, over 80% of the decisions taken in this House are decisions that are cascaded down from Europe to us. So the public rightly voted to get out of Europe. In terms of this vision, I'm not sure where the actual vision is in the document, and Mr. Aiken didn't make a great job of demonstrating much of a vision. Perhaps the person who's winding up, will be able to show us where this clear strategic vision is. Let's be very clear. We are in a negotiation period, and that negotiation will be led by our national government. And I'm proud to be part of the United Kingdom, and I am proud to put my faith in our national government to negotiate on behalf of the United Kingdom as a whole. Our executive will be consistently and constantly in contact with our national government during those negotiations, outlining the various issues which are of strategic importance to Northern Ireland. And it will not be done blasted across the media and the newspapers. It will be done in a very positive manner, in the way that government should do it, privately, and deliver the deal for the people in the United Kingdom.
I thank the member for giving way, and the point that he makes is that the Northern Ireland Executive will be involved. But isn't it the case that the Northern Ireland Executive are already involved, that they're already discussing with other ministers, that they have already told their officials to get on with the work of preparing? And if the other opposition parties were so good, they would have been questioning our ministers and finding out that detail, and then that they would have that, because the work is going on, and it torpedoes the argument that other parties have made in here that they've gotten away with, that nothing is being done.
Well, you see, a little knowledge is dangerous, and thankfully the member has dispensed some good knowledge to us today. The Ulster Unionist Party have little knowledge because they decided to get outside of the camp, so they don't know what's going on, and then they create this, that things are not happening, when in actual fact things are happening. We will be involved in those negotiations. We will be dealing with Theresa May, David Davis, Boris Johnson, and the key people who will
Jim Allister. Mr. Allister, you have 4 minutes left.
Well, in the day that's in it, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I regret that you haven't used your prerogative to extend my 4 minutes, but there you are. The content of this document, I have to say, in many places, is quite haphazard and random, but the colour scheme is excellent. But I think we do need to recognise that the Ulster Unionist Party has produced more than any of the rest of us, because they've produced a document more than any other party, my own included, has produced in this House, and more in the realms where the expectation would be greater than the executive has produced. Hence, of course, the rather churlish and embarrassed response from the executive benches in this debate. Because, though yes, this document can be properly critiqued and criticised on many fronts, it is, as I say, more than what anyone else has produced, least of all the executive. And of course it highlights the fact that we have an executive pulling in opposite directions on this seminal issue. We have Sinn Féin wanting to stay in Europe, the DUP wanting to leave Europe. No surprise then that there is no cogency, no coherence to anything that has been said on behalf of the executive as a whole. And no surprise then that there is no document from them. I'm saddened that in this debate, many of the Ramoners are still fighting the battle they've lost. on the Sinn Féin and SDLP and Alliance benches, we've had some of the Japanese soldiers who are still fighting the war in the Philippine jungle. The referendum's over. You lost. We're leaving the EU. Get over it. And get into a state of mind where we're going to grasp the opportunities that have voted. And I welcome the fact that the Ulster Unionist Party in this document has accepted that we're leaving the EU. And when we leave, it must be all of the United Kingdom that leaves on equal terms. There can be no such thing as special status that keeps Northern Ireland half in and half out. We went in as one nation, we leave as one nation. And there must be no compromise on that fundamental issue. Some of the content of this document I've indicated, some of it doesn't impress me. I'm not impressed, for example, by the suggestion that we should devolve to Northern Ireland the issuing of visas. That should never be a devolved issue in a United Kingdom. It is totally incompatible with having a United Kingdom to have different visa arrangements such as that. We have this incongruous proposal of a peace centre. It seems to come out of the blue for whatever reason. Suggestion of a war room. Well, there might be some from the ranks who might be in the war room with a little more paramilitary or military experience than others, but I think what we need is a cogency.
Would the member bring his remarks to a close, please?
And embracing the opportunities.
The time's up.
That lie ahead. It's not about making the best of a bad job. It's about embracing the opportunities which are manifold in leaving the EU.
I call Mike Nesbitt to wind on the debate.
Deputy Speaker, thank you very much. May I thank all the members who have been here, particularly those who have contributed to this debate. The first formal opposition day is next Monday. I'm pleased that, as it were, the final warm-up match was on such an important issue as the future of Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom outside of the European Union. Particularly pleased to see so many members of the Democratic Unionist Party with us. I'm just glad the debate didn't clash with the Conservative Party conference, because I know you're very keen on a little champagne reception at lunchtime. No austerity for the members of the DUP there. And, of course, in bed in government with Sinn Féin, and all Mr Murphy can do is make a very tired, jaded reference back to the 2010 general election. Well, I would say to him, were he here, I am very confident that historians can look at our association in one general election with the Conservative Party and tell us what damage that did to the vulnerable compared to his party's lifetime support of the provisional IRA campaign and what it did to the vulnerable of this country. Mr Murphy was among those who were quite disparaging of the document, knocked off over a cup of coffee on a Friday afternoon, I think he said. And we heard Mr Alistair there saying he thought it was a bit confusing. And others have been less than complimentary. Well, that's fine, but it isn't just our work. It was brought together as the result of bringing together a Brexit advisory panel for the Ulster Unionist Party, populated by industrialists, by business people. The trade unions were involved there, universities were in there, we had farmers, we also had people from the agri-food processing side, we had economists, and we have others. And the Lord Morrow, from a sedentary position, asked me to name them. Well, my point to the Lord Morrow is this. You don't know who they are, but they know who you are, those of you who are criticising their work as shoddy. Deputy Speaker, this opposition will do two things. We will scrutinise, and where appropriate, we will offer an alternative. And scrutiny does not necessarily mean criticism. It means to take a close look, but when criticism is due, we will criticise. And we are highly critical of what the executive has failed to do in the run-up to the 23rd of June and in its aftermath. There was no contingency planning for potentially the biggest development for the United Kingdom since the Second World War. There were only two outcomes, and the executive planned for only one, business as usual. In response to a written question from me about contingency plans, the First Minister wrote back and said, "We have instructed Sir Malcolm McKibben, as head of the civil service, to start doing things." No clearer proof that nothing was done in advance. Then we have the letter of the 10th of August. Now, fair enough, they wrote to the Prime Minister. They defined five areas of concern, and quite right to do so. But I have to say, Deputy Speaker, those five areas of concern were as obvious on the 10th of June as they were on the 10th of August. And then, for a two-party coalition, just two parties, not to be able to put on a united front when the Secretary of State, responsible for the United Kingdom exiting the European Union, came to visit, is a sin. A house divided has no leverage in political negotiations. Now, I know Mr. Poots is proud that his United Kingdom government is going to negotiate on our behalf. I know he says he has every confidence in the United Kingdom government to negotiate on our behalf and protect the interests of the people of Northern Ireland. I will not give way. I will use my 10 minutes, and I will not be giving way. I have four words for Mr. Poots. The Anglo-Irish Agreement. That's four words, Mr. Poots. Not three. And clearly you were never finance minister, and thank the Lord for it. So, we will scrutinise and we will offer an alternative. Now, this, of course, is not an alternative because there's nothing to give an alternative to, but it is the next best thing. And it's built on an approach that sees three legs. A vision, and again for Mr. Poots's benefit, our vision is of Northern Ireland as the United Kingdom's gateway to the European Union, because we do have that land border. Then there is a plan. And the plan is built around the fact that we need to get together the intellectual capacity and the resource to handle six sets of negotiations, not just our withdrawal from the EU, but our new set of arrangements with them, negotiations with the World Trade Organization, negotiations with third countries, negotiations with London, and actually negotiations within ourselves. What are our policy priorities? What are the options? And what do we want to achieve? And as Mrs. Hannah said, the UK's priorities will not necessarily be Northern Ireland's. Take our universities, for example. There is a fear that I have heard articulated by senior members of our universities that while there will be additional money for research after Brexit has been completed, it is more likely to go to the triangle of the universities in London, Oxford and Cambridge than it is to come to the two universities in Northern Ireland. And the fact that Queen's is a so-called Russell Group university does not guarantee them any special status in terms of resource over the University of Ulster, or Ulster University, as they now call themselves. So Mr. Aitken opened the debate very well, I thought, by giving a comparison between what we have failed to do against the achievements so far of Scotland, Wales, the City of London, our own Secretary of State, the importance on universities, on infrastructure, and not just the agri-food sector, which is where we tend to concentrate first. The voluntary and community sector potentially are going to lose out big time in terms of funding. And then we had a sparkling contribution from Mr. Stulford. Uncosted and untested, he said. Untested, said Mr. Stulford. What about number six in our 10 asks? It's the common travel area, Deputy Speaker. What's untested about the common travel area? It's been around longer than the member for South Belfast has been alive. And he says our proposals are uncosted. Of course they are. These are not proposals to take money out of the current block grant, the current budget, to take from one department to give to the other. These are the asks that we should get out of the UK government to take out of what we are told was going to be the tsunami of repatriated sterling, which would no longer be going to Brussels if we voted for Brexit. So, of course, these are asks that are a wish list and which are not fully costed. But Mr Stulford is still counting the votes, still fighting the referendum. 52% of the United Kingdom said, we come out. And then he's followed by his partner in government, John O'Dowd, for Sinn Féin, who says the important vote was the 56 in Northern Ireland who voted to remain. A House divided has no leverage in negotiations. It is time to move beyond Brexiteers and Remainers. The people of the United Kingdom have voted. They have voted that we come out. We have to seize the opportunities that are inherent within that situation. Mr. Lyons opened looking to the past, accused us of walking away, in some sense, from the devolved institutions, and yet we all voted to create an official opposition. And if we're going to talk about disrespecting the institutions, what about the use of the royal prerogative? What's democratic about Mrs. Foster and Mr. McGuinness, particularly Mr. McGuinness, a proud Republican, conferring upon himself the privileges and the authority of a monarch? Queen Marlene the First decided we'll have a new executive, press executive. What's democratic about that? And wonderful interventions from Mr. Poots and Mr. Stulford, a very sneering critique of those who sneer. As Mr. Smith put it, my colleague in Strangford, we are the most affected area and yet the least prepared. Deputy Speaker, there's been a lot of talk about the content of the document, not about the motion, because the motion isn't about accepting the content of the document. The document makes clear these are initial thoughts. What the motion says is that we call on the House to adopt the approach contained in the document, the approach, and that is a vision, a plan, and some key asks, which will be tests of whether we have achieved what we wanted to achieve. So, you vote for this, or you vote for this, because nobody's given an alternative approach. I commend it to the House.
Members, the question now is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think in those circumstances we clear the lobbies and the question will be put in 3 minutes. Thank you. Order. Members will resume their seats, please. The question is that the motion on the standing order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Okay. Do we have tellers? Would the tellers approach the table, please? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are... Order, order please. Tellers for the ayes are Steve Aiken and Mike Nesbitt. Tellers for the noes are George Robinson and Declan McAleer. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Thank you. Can we secure the doors, please? Order, please. Can I ask the clerk read the result?
85 members voted, 15 members voted aye, 70 members voted no. One member who voted in both lobbies is not included in these results. The motion falls.
The motion falls. Unfasten the doors, please. As question time begins at 2 o'clock, I suggest that the House takes at ease until then, and the other debate will commence after question time. Thank you.